Thank you. Thank you, President, Chair, chers collègues. Comme toujours, c'est un honneur pour moi de vous discuter l'issue de entre les sexes. Now, it's an important year for us. It's the 25th year of the Beijing Declaration. It has been 20 years since we all agreed on 1325, which is women in the whole process of peace and security. And I think, as always, I have to say to you, have we come far? Have we come anywhere? Have we gone backwards? And indeed, we found that we have made strides. We always make strides. But I think what we tend to do is we tend to move two steps forward and one step backward. So our progress is always slightly lagging in every issue. And today, we see that the OSCE region has polarized a great deal in terms of its attitude towards gender equality, towards violence against women, towards issues of diversity and intersectionality. But that does not mean that the OSCE Secretary General and our own Secretary General, Roberta Montella, haven't really embraced the idea of gender equality and of opportunity for equal opportunity for women and men in this region. And they have worked very hard to try and make this happen. In areas where they could, we have seen them moving forward, more women in positions within the Secretariat and appointing more women to areas that are important in terms of the institution. Yet the challenges remain. I know that in Morocco everyone was really concerned that there weren't very many women there, that the panels did not have any women on them. And you and I, as colleagues, know that women are as capable, sometimes some of us say even more capable, of doing the kinds of things that men are chosen to do. And so it is a problem when we don't see a lot of women represented on the stage speaking to issues that are very important to them. And I think there are some challenges that we have to recognize in this not happening, in the reason why this is not moving forward. And I'm going to ask you, as my colleagues and as delegations, to please try, when you come to these meetings and in the summer meeting in Vancouver, for you to bring women on your delegations, for us to see more women as head of delegations, and so that they can be represented in this forum, in all of the debates, and the ability to speak out. When you second people to the OSCE and the OSCE, please second women. Women are as capable. You can find capable women. I'm asking you to make a special effort to do this, because we all know that when we leave over 50% of our populations behind, there is no way we're going to thrive economically, socially, culturally, and or politically. So I'm just hoping that I can appeal to you to do this. I am now going to appeal to the women in this organization and say, you have got to put your hand up and say, me, I'm going to run. Yes, I'm going to go for vice president. Yes, I'm going to go for chairs of the three committees. So you have to step up and you have to let your name be counted. And I think you would find that in this forum, you will have a lot of your male colleagues supporting you in some of these areas. So I think we've talked about some of the challenges. I think we need to move forward. And I know that we do have pushback against women in the peace and security agenda. And I'm hoping that some of our colleagues who are nation states that have not put resources into moving the agenda forward with regard to women in peace and security, even though we know that having women at all stages of conflict, pre-conflict, post-conflict, negotiations, etc., that when women are there, that the solutions are very different, and that sometimes we can get more sustainable solutions in the long run. So again, I'm asking you to step up to the bar and to help us. I was very impressed today when the ambassador from the United Kingdom talked a little bit about organized crime, because we do know that organized crime is part of what continues to keep women and, by extension, children exploited in terms of trafficking, for labor reasons, for sexual reasons. And so we need to also remember that organized crime is a key part of what we do as we go back to our parliaments and we try to make a difference in what is happening and how we bring forward legislation and policies and programs that will assist us in ensuring that we have both men and women sitting at the table together, making very good decisions and very many solutions that we have not been able to come up with because we haven't had both sides at the table. Now, I just want to talk a little bit about what we're hoping to do in the summer and what I'm going to focus on in this summer meeting. And I'm hoping that you would go back to your parliaments and you would think about it and that you would actually recognize that this is not just a timely issue that I want us to talk about. It's a very urgent issue. And it's got to do with the fact that women in politics and women in journalism face extraordinary threats. They face psychological threats, they face online threats, they face harassment, many of them are physically threatened, and some have died. We do know in our own OSCPA region where female politicians have been murdered and where we see female journalists also being targeted. Now, we cannot do very much online because obviously there are people who refuse to be named who continue to threaten women. But the important thing here is, if we continue, and it is really to silence the voices of women in the media, women speaking out, women saying where they see problems, women trying to find solutions, and as politicians, women who stand up in their parliaments and they speak out and they try to make change. We know that this is about silencing the voices of women, and we as parliamentarians have to speak out and really push back against this. I think the problem here is that if we don't have women in journalism writing the truth and telling truths about what is going on globally, we won't really know, and we will be fed false information, disinformation, especially by we know social media and online perpetrators. And the important thing about women, if women no longer want to run, we talk about women's participation in politics. We talk about encouraging women to run in their parliaments. Why would women want to run if they're terrified and they're scared for their lives and they're at great risk themselves and their families? So democracy here is at risk. The ability for freedom of the press and the ability of women to sit in parliament and make decisions alongside our male colleagues is at risk, and therefore democracy is threatened. As we look at our region and we look at how that so many threats are being perpetrated, whether they're human problems with humanitarian crises, whether they're migration issues, whether they're in fact trafficking issues, we know that we need to have women at the table. And I'm hoping that we will discuss this in fullness at the summer forum in Vancouver, and I'm hoping that you come armed to be able to participate and speak, especially at the gender luncheon. And I know that many of my male colleagues in this room have spoken out and have been rapporteurs and have had much to say in terms of support of this problem. But I think the important thing is if threats and intimidation will prevent women from being there within a free press and women to sit in our parliaments, then we have a real problem. And I think we need to flag it and we need to talk seriously about what we intend to do, not just talk about, but what we intend to do about this. Now, I think I just wanted to end here because I know that I don't have a lot of time and I prefer to hear from you from the floor telling me what you think and making your comments on this particular issue. And I just want to say I'm looking forward to seeing you in Vancouver. I'm hoping that we will have an exciting time there. I know that our Migration Committee is going to be meeting with integration groups, with migrant resources, with private sponsors for immigration. You are free to come if you wish to come and attend July the 1st, which is a national day for Canada, and come to one of our citizenship ceremonies. You'll be welcome. Just let us know so we can make sure that you have seats in the room to come and see this. Now you will find in Vancouver not just the beautiful Pacific Ocean, but you will see the beautiful mountains that ring our province of British Columbia. You will also find that you will get every single type of food and cuisine in Vancouver, whether it is Korean, whether it's Japanese, whether it is Thai, or it could be cuisine from your own countries. You will meet your fellow countrymen there in Canada, countrymen and countrywomen, who will be speaking your languages, who will be able to wander amongst you and show you that your culture from many of the 57 states is alive and well and thriving in Canada, and that the languages are spoken and the people feel free to walk around and talk to you. So multiculturalism is going to be a big part of what we present to you when we are in Vancouver. So let's come, let's have a good time, and also I will tell you, we know how to party. So thanks, guys.